The search for challenges leads us beyond our barriers. For Roger Bannister, that moment he went beneath the 4-minute mile. For those in the mold of Sir Edmund Hillary, it's the conquest of the awesome heights of Everest deep in the Himalayas. For others, it has been the threatening north wall of Mount Eiger in the Alps. For the spirit of St. Louis, with Charles Lindbergh at the controls, the barrier was as vast as the Atlantic Ocean. For Chuck Yeager, the barrier was a snap in time when he became the first man to penetrate Mach 1, the sound barrier. For this man, Stanley Barrett, in his 48,000 horsepower rocket-propelled vehicle, the barrier is out there, an invisible wall obtainable only at over 700 miles per hour, the sound barrier in a land vehicle. Project SOS, a new challenge for the speed of sound, is a CBS Sports special. It appears like a fragile children's toy, not a weapon with which to break down walls, nor carry a man to his destiny. And yet those are the only reasons for its existence. It seems impossible that a knowing, caring person would lock himself into a tiny cockpit and ignite enough power to light a small city in an effort to go faster than any man on Earth. Yet in this space-age device, that is what Stanley Barrett, a quiet, gentle man, has in mind. Who is Stan Barrett? For over a decade, he's been one of the motion picture world's leading stuntmen, as he proved once again in Hooper.
Cut.
Who is Stan Barrett?
Well, I would have to say he's a very highly motivated individual. And he's very honest and sincere. And I think at times it gets him in a lot of trouble because people don't quite understand that. They don't take it in the proper way.
Stanley Barrett is a fighter, an ex-St. Louis Golden Gloves champion. He's been Paul Newman's stuntman and compatriot for some 10 years.
He's an enigma. He is, on one hand, the most devout family man, very religious, very tender and very loving. And on the other hand, he's a killer of some sort. You know, he's got black belts, 2 black belts in karate. He's Golden Gloves champion, great motocross rider and motorcycle. So how you balance that off, I really don't know, because he runs the entire spectrum. He really does.
Project SOS, Stan Barrett's effort to attain the speed of sound, will begin in a moment. It will take only 2 days to transport car designer Bill Frederick's 2-year labor of love and lifetime of dreams, his rocket car, to its destination at the fastest racetrack in the world. Stanley Barrett feels it's been a lifetime effort to perfect a body and spirit necessary to his task. He lives in Bishop, California with his wife, the former international ski champion and Olympic medal winner of the 1960s, Penny McCoy. They have 3 children. Now, this is Stanton, the cruiser, age 6, carrying the ball, while his brother David is on defense. And there is Missy, the pistol. She's 4. They seem a typical young California couple, except in one regard, the father's work. As a Hollywood stuntman, on one day, he is set on fire. On the next, he may be blown up. And still another day, thrown off a roof. Stan Barrett, sound barrier contender, trains for every event like a title fight, and he does not fit the stereotyped Hollywood mold.
I really feel that there's so much dependent on me in this thing, and that
I really feel that there's no substitute for preparation. And I want to be as in as good a physical shape as I can be in, so that I feel as sharp as I can, and I just want to have as many things going for me as possible.
Stanley Barrett's story is the story of seeking perfection, a story of willpower, of overcoming odds, of overcoming incredible injuries.
Stan's convinced he's healed before we get started. And so this positive attitude that he has a positive attitude about everything, not just healing, but in this sense, when you're treating somebody like this, you have a great advantage. But genetically, he's the type of person, you know, he's in such good shape, and is, I suppose it's built into his metabolism, but this attitude that he has, this positive attitude, is what...
I think that could be a negative sometimes. I mean, if you just got him sewed back together and he decided he was well again the next day, that could be a problem.
Yeah. It is a problem sometimes, because he decides sometimes he's well before he is well. And the first time I operated him, his wife called me two nights later, and he'd already taken the cast off of his leg. The cast should have been on for 6 weeks. So I gave him a lecture and another cast, and then I catch him whittling pieces, and he's out trying to jog with his cast on, and
that's not recommended, is it?
That's not recommended. Yeah, there's a time to be still, but following that, there's a time when you've got to do certain things. And he decides very early that it's time to advance his activity level, and he goes ahead and does it.
You know, it's funny. The times that I was hurt were usually times that I was showing off.
Is that right?
Yeah. And I've been hurt very few times doing a stunt. It's usually the times when I'm showing off or doing something, letting my ego motivate me, and then every time it seems like I get spanked.
Tell me the story about when you had your kneecap out and you couldn't walk, and one of your sons, Stanton or David, came through.
I'd had my kneecap removed probably about 9 months before that, or a year, and then I had a back surgery done.
A stunt?
Yes, a back fusion from a series of stunts. And so I'd get out of the car sometimes and fall down. I couldn't. She'd have to help me out of bed, and I'd roll on the floor and crawl over to the dresser and then pick myself up and everything. And as I started trying to get in shape, I would go out and try to run, and I came in one day, and I was just tears in my eyes. I said, you know, I can't even run. I said, I can't even hardly take a step. And I was just praying that I could, that if I could just run 100 yards, I'd be satisfied. And I came into the kitchen, and Penny and David were there, and I just told Penny, I said, I'm so discouraged, you know. I said, I don't think I'll ever be able to make a comeback. And David looked up, and he said, Daddy, he said, I'll help you run. So we went out. I said, okay, David. And we went out, and he could, as fast as he could run, I could just about walk. And but he would go out with me faithfully every day, and pretty soon I was running.
While Stanley Barrett works out in his final hours at home, Bill Frederick's convoy made a fuel stop, not at your average filling station. Each of those boxes contains one Sidewinder missile. If necessary, with its 6,000 horsepower, 3,000 pounds of thrust, used up in 6 seconds. It could be the top-off to get
Evan's
Barrett through
down.
The speed of sound.
And ready to go, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay,
you want to close up the doors?
With this stop, the last detail for the assault on Mach 1 had been collected. Stan Barrett is striving for more than a body necessary for stunt work or sound barriers, and that is why he chooses to run high in the mountains rather than near his valley home.
Well, I think because it's a challenge to me. It's also a good exercise and discipline, and it's just a time when I feel very close to God up here. You don't have all the other distractions down in the valley, and it's just a time to really... As I say, be alone, and you can really meditate on a lot of different things.
Daybreak, August 30th, 1979. The SOS convoy is nearly in sight of its destination. Campbell, Arfons, Thompson, Breedlove, Gabelich, the seekers of ultimate speed challenge have each edged toward other dons on this road that leads to the heart of speed, velocity, courage. Land's End, a world of dreams for some, nightmares for others. For rocket car builder Bill Fredericks, it's a returning, a re-engagement with an old adversary.
They call it a wasteland, but it's beautiful to me. I want to go for it. I want the speed of sound. It's been my goal since I've been a kid, and I'm going to do it this time.
Project SOS, man's effort for the sound barrier on land, will continue in a moment.
Hi, I'm Brock Yates. In this strange half-airplane, half-automobile, a brave young man named Stanley Barrett will attempt to become the first human being to surpass the speed of sound on the surface of the Earth. You know, I've seen a lot of weird and pretty wonderful things in the world of automobiles, but nothing compares to that special moment when a man straps himself into a bizarre, overpowered vehicle like this and charges into the unknown. Monday, September 3rd, 1979. Stan Barrett takes his first high-speed run in the car, a mere saunter across the salt flats at 350 miles an hour. This is the way it went during the final moments before Stan made his first run. But even with a crew of 16 expert technicians and engineers, a lost wrench can only be retrieved by a 12-year-old boy. What kind of a vehicle does it take to transport Stan Barrett through the sound barrier? This car, 39 feet long, about 3,500 pounds minus fuel for its 48,000 horsepower rocket motor, with 11,800 hand-fabricated pieces, painstakingly assembled by Bill Frederick and his crew in his Chatsworth, California, backyard garage. For 2 years, Frederick and a small cadre of devoted friends molded and machined into reality this marvelous tool for raw speed. But this is no hobbyist toy. This vehicle has been created from the latest in space-age technology and advanced components. For example, these stabilizer wings control the stability of the car at over 600 miles an hour. And this special aluminum alloy skin is held down by 5,300 of the latest kinds of screws also used in the space shuttle. In this 14-foot section directly in front of the cockpit is housed the propellant and rocket fuels. During a less hectic moment, designer Bill Frederick explained how this complex system works.
This is the front end of the car, where the front wheel fits down in this section. The suspension is a hydroelastic strut system that is pneumatically powered and uses a pneumatic spring. On the front of the car, in front of the front wheel, we have the servo dome loaders, which operate the pressure system in the rocket. And in the nose, we have the radio system, which is a duplex Motorola system. Right here is our canard. The canards fit out here, and they're to control the front end of the car so we don't have any pitching moment. Keep the nose down on the ground. This section, this gray section here, is the pressure vessel. The front section carries 2,000 psi of nitrogen, and it powers the hydrogen peroxide, which is in the backside. It's a thin tank. You can hear it. It's made out of 17.7 pH, which is the precipitation hardening stainless. And it's heat-treated to a 260,000-pound tensile strength.
Here's the cockpit, protected by this supersonic fighter's windshield. About $15,000 a copy, by the way. Stanley Barrett fits in here, if you can believe it. No more than about a 5-foot-10-inch man and about 150 pounds maximum weight can fit in here amongst all the instrumentation. But then again, he's only going to be in here for about 45 seconds during a supersonic run.
These are the gauges that the driver sees. This is the steering accumulator. It keeps about 600 PSI pressure in the steering. This is a primary high pressure, a secondary high pressure. The actuator, accumulator pressure, which operates all the valve. This is the energy that's used to operate the valves. These two are very important to the driver. This is the H2O2 pressure vessel pressure, which tells the driver exactly how much pressure he has on his main oxidizer. This is critical when he is dialing up power. And this is a drogue accumulator that tells him how much pressure is in the drogue accumulator that blows out the drogue slugs that deploy the chutes. So the driver watches these very close just before he's going to run. And if he's in these, we abort the run. This is the steering wheel, which is a little 6-inch butterfly wheel. The steering is very slow. He can make a turn almost half the steering wheel, half 180 degrees, and it only turns a car like you would turn your normal steering wheel about an inch or two. This is the driver's compartment. The driver is held in by a 12-point seat belt system, which includes belts that go around his helmet to keep his helmet in place so his head won't, just in case there was an accident, his head won't bounce around inside. This is a canopy where the driver opens to get in the car. When the driver enters a car, he enters facing backwards, gets about 3/4 of the way in, and then rolls over to get in. These are the switches that he operates. When we first start the countdown procedures, it takes about 5 minutes, and the driver operates these switches in different sequences as he is told to over the radio from the telemetry room. These switches here, this one is the main secondary throttle valve, this one is the rocket arming valve, and this one is a charge that blows the chute fairings off. And as the driver is driving from standing still up to 800 miles an hour, he won't operate any switches. He'll just look straight ahead and have his hands on the steering wheel. As soon as he comes right to the end where he wants to terminate thrust, he releases his foot, hits these three switches here, which give him a triple fail-safe to make sure the rocket is off so he won't burn the chutes off.
Beneath this streamlined skirt lies one of the vehicle's three wheels, fabricated from a terribly exotic forging technique out of aluminum alloy. Bill Fredericks has four of them in his kit for the price of $26,000. That gives him three to use and one spare. The dorsal fin, for stability at high speeds, also houses the antennas for the radios and the telemetry equipment. And down here in this short, incredibly compact little space lies the multi-thousand horsepower rocket engines and its booster systems, as well as the parachutes. The last time I saw a vehicle like this, it was nose down in the Nevada sagebrush. My pal Hal Needham had crash-landed it there after losing his brakes and his chute at over 600 miles an hour during a run for the land speed record. But this car is vastly improved over that one with larger brakes and larger parachutes. But Stan's gonna need it, believe me, because he's going to try to go about 150 miles an hour faster than Hal.
The effort of Bill Frederick's rocket car to break the speed of sound on land will continue in a moment.
I'm Hal Needham. I'm the last person to attempt to be the fastest man in the world. I drove the old SMI motivator rocket car 620 miles an hour. I used to be a wingwalker. I have over 500 parachute jumps. For the last 20 years, I've made my living as a Hollywood stuntman. But that day in 1976 in Tonopah, Nevada, was the most frightening day of my life.
2, 1, ignition.
Off and a good one this time, Ken.
Thunderous send-off to Hal Needham. Climbing to 400 to 500, almost 550 miles per hour and still climbing.
At 620 miles an hour, my parachute failed to open. My brakes were unable to stop me. 34 seconds, 5.5 miles later, I came to and ran off at the end of the dry lake.
At tremendous speed. He is headed for the end of the course. His chute just came out. His chute deployed, but it has not opened.
Ken, it has not opened. He might be in very serious trouble down there.
He's missed the red flags, and he has crashed at the end of the course. He is off the course. We can't tell you exactly how far off, but he has crashed off the end of Mud Lake. Hal Needham in the rocket car.
I want to tell you something. The last couple of hundred yards is a sauna gun.
Brock Yates down
Ken Squire, Brock Yates, and Mickey Thompson were there to describe the end of my ride.
When he reached the end of the course, the end of the lake, he was traveling at 200 miles per hour. He made a slight veer to the right, and that's probably what saved him. There's a tiny valley here. He shot off through this sagebrush, down across this dry creek, at about 150 miles per hour, and landed for the first time out here, right here where the nose sunk in, and then took a 65-foot leap to where Mickey Thompson is standing.
There's no question this had to be one of Hal Needham's most frightening rides, as indicated by this deep groove in the ground. His next move was 165 feet over the next hill to where Brock Yates is standing.
Mickey, Hal definitely saved the best till last. This may have been his greatest stunt ever. Over half a football field through the air to land in this mound of sagebrush.
Since then, my life has changed. I've become a director, and my credits are Smokey and the Bandit, Hooper and the Villain. They enable me to own the thoroughbred instead of ride it. But the barrier that lays out here is still super important to me. That's the reason that when my friend Stan Barrett hits Mach 1 for the first time in a land vehicle, I'll be here. Stanley is the latest in a long line of American speed challengers. Henry Ford was one of the first. His efforts for a land speed record in the early 1900s was unique because he ran on a lake, frozen Lake St. Clair, 92 miles an hour. It might have been chilly, but old Henry warmed things up considerably. Then the Europeans refused to accept his time because they did not recognize the American Automobile Association as a sanctioning body. It was a time when aerodynamics were definitely not a major concern for speed barrier challengers. But it did get serious when Sir Malcolm Campbell came to Daytona. But it got even more serious when Frank Lockhart died there in 1928. Sir Malcolm Campbell first came to Bonneville in 1935. The Englishman became the first man to travel over 300 miles an hour, and with this run, made Bonneville mean ultimate land speed. If you think getting a good ride is difficult today, consider John Cobb's flight, who had to walk the plank in 1939 as an opener to his 369-mile-an-hour record run. John Cobb's effort in the Railton Special brought the barrier to nearly 400 miles per hour as pre-World War II activities concluded. And then came the Hot Rodders. There was Mickey Thompson, who did over 400 miles an hour in his backyard creation, the Challenger. Don Campbell, son of Sir Malcolm, took up the challenge with his $3 million new edition of the Bluebird. At 345 miles an hour, he reduced the project to rubble. He was lucky to be alive. Then came the monster, Art R. Font's jet-powered Green Monster. In 1964, R. Font's achieved a speed of 536 miles an hour. By 1966, the challenge was 600 miles per hour, and Art Arfons, on November the 17th, took his final run at that barrier. The timers had Arfons at over 610 miles per hour when he created his own special place in the records. He was a victim of the highest speed motorsports crash in history. His car rolled over and over, covering nearly a mile. Luckily, he suffered no serious injuries. Today, Art R. Font's barrier is not 600 miles an hour ultimate speed, but 6 tons of dead weight. He is one of the nation's leading tractor pullers. We went to Akron, Ohio, and talked with Art R. Font
what happened at Bonneville?
I had not gone to oil lubrication in my wheel bearings, and when your wheels start turning over 6,000, the grease dries up. And I just dried up a bearing, and it froze and took the whole wheel right off the car. I seen the horizon was on the wrong side. The windshield's the first indication I had I was in trouble, you know. It was upside down. And that first flip was 527 feet before it hit the ground, so that was conscious that long.
If Art Arfonts could give Stan Barrett one piece of advice, what would it be?
Well, if he's going to work up to it gradually, then he's going to know what he's getting into. And I'd say just don't do it all at once.
Art Arfonts, who in the 60s battled with this man to be the very fastest. Craig Breedlove in 1965 was the first person over 600 miles per hour in his incredible Spirit of America car. And then came Gary Gabelich, who posted in 1970 at Bonneville two-way run at 622 miles per hour, with one of the runs at over 630 miles per hour. The Blue Flame and Gabelich became the fastest pair on the face of the earth. To go beyond the marks of these great men and travel approximately 750 miles an hour through the sound barrier is the aim of this man, Stanley Barrett.
This is a 9-mile marker. Stanley is going to start at zero. By the time he hits Mach 1 and coasts to a stop, it's going to be somewhere in the vicinity of this marker. And I'm going to be here to meet him. You know, I've been asked 1,000 times why I'm not driving a car. So I'm going to answer that for a lot of people at one time right now. I like to tell myself it's because I'm rich and I don't have to drive the car. But deep down inside, I think that ride in Tonopah, Nevada, left me with a lot of sleepless nights.
Project SOS will continue in a moment. Thursday, September 6, 1979. Time, 10:02 a.m. The winds are at 1.4 miles per hour. The temperature, 79 degrees. The effort for 450 miles per hour. Bill Frederick's Shepherds, his rocket vehicle.
Little bitty one, here it comes.
Stan Barrett ready. The final moments of countdown. Awesome power of the rocket car, climbing to 300, to 400, and finally to 466.184 miles per hour. At 460 miles per hour, Stanley Barrett sees the half-mile markers flying by like fence posts. Double it approximately, and you have a feeling for the sound barrier. To take the G-loads necessary for this endeavor, positive and negative G-load, Stan Barrett was tested on the centrifuge at the University of Southern California. This was 5 G's, five times his own body weight, still capable of controlling the butterfly steering wheel, still capable of controlling the instrumentation that operates his fuel and safety systems. The unknown commodity here is what happens when he's under a heavy positive G-load, deploys his chutes, and takes a tremendous jolt of negative G-load, and perhaps blacks out. In the rocket car, he will be nearly in a prone position and more subject to the forces of G-loading. The pressures make it difficult to breathe. The doctors had said Stanley probably wouldn't function past 4 G's. Finally, he withstood not only 5, but 6 G's. Later, near Bonneville, I found in more than a physical sense that Stan Barrett is a remarkable person.
Why? Why do you like to get away?
Well, I think to really reflect on what's going on and just to kind of meditate on really what's important and my priorities. And to
what are your priorities?
I think my main priority is my relationship to the Lord and my family.
Are you afraid of being hurt?
I don't think you're going to get hurt in this thing. I think you're going to get killed if something happens. I mean, I don't... With those kind of speeds and that kind of energy that you're developing, if you have an accident, I think you're in big trouble. I think anything over 350 miles an hour, you're going to have pretty serious consequences if you have an accident. No, I'm not afraid of getting hurt, and I'm certainly not afraid of dying. I'm not looking to get out of here before my time, for sure, but I'm as prepared to die as I am to live. But I certainly don't want to leave my family, and I want to enjoy them for many, many more years to come.
So why take the risk?
I knew you were going to ask me that, Ken. Because I believe that it's a, I think it's a pretty calculated risk, that I really believe that we can do it, or I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't get in the car. What may seem like a risk to someone else may not seem like one to me. I mean, I've been a stuntman for 14 years now, and I've done a lot of things that probably seemed to other people really crazy. But to me, I knew where the boundaries were. I had a good sense of what would work and what wouldn't work, and I had a confidence in my ability to be able to make a decision whether I should do it or not. And I'm just not, you know, look at the people that have driven the cars before that have really gone fast. Hal and Kitty O'Neill drove a similar car to this that's not as refined as this, 600 and some odd miles an hour. I believe that this car is capable of going a lot faster than their car did, and, you know, nothing happened to them. I mean, Hal ran out of lake. But I feel very confident the car will make it, and I think it'll do it safely.
You saw the vehicle. Would you ever consider a thing like that for yourself?
Absolutely not.
No twinges, just to give it a tweak.
I wouldn't even sit in that thing in the garage.
What significance does this have down here in this valley, in that salt?
Well, I think that that could perhaps be a launching platform, you might say, into giving us the platform to speak out on issues that we feel are important. It's a big step for us. We've really prayed about things, and we really feel that it's really important that we start looking for to do things that really have some eternal significance rather than just significance here on Earth.
Project SOS will continue in a moment. Run 5, September 6, time 7:34 in the evening. The first attempt at 500 miles an hour. Is perfect, the operation flawless. The following morning at breakfast on site, I met the original conqueror of the sound barrier, retired General Chuck Yeager, the guy they said had the right stuff. Did this outfit have the right stuff to go to the barrier?
Yeah, I think so. They got the thrust, and it's a damn well-designed piece of equipment. Beautiful. I'd love to drive it. Back when we were working on the X1 in 1947, you know, things were pretty crude. That's a real keen car.
How crude were they?
Well, you know, the thing was we didn't know anything about the speed of sound or what it meant. We just knew we were in trouble as airplanes started buffeting. And it was a barrier, you know, unless we got through it, the airplanes were pretty well limited, and our whole space program would never come back about had we not gotten through the speed of sound.
In the course of events, one man had a change of heart about the project.
Paul, I thought you said you'd never get in it.
Well, that's the way things go, guys.
Think there's any question whether you'll make it the next time?
Oh, yeah, I think you'll do it. I'd like to drive this turkey.
So do you have to back up again?
No, no, you can come out. You can twist right there. Okay, come right out.
Sure glad this son of a on
fire. P.L. Newman has become a fine race car driver. Paul Newman is one of the world's great actors. Newman, as a rocket car driver, needs a little coaching on entrances and exits. Time 11:24. Wind speed 2.6 miles per hour. Barrett ready for another run. He is at the line.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
And there is a problem on blastoff. The rocket fails to fire. It is fully armed. It rolls slowly down the line, still containing all of its propellant, comes to a halt. The area around the rocket car is quadranted off a mile back. No one is allowed near except Bill Fredericks and his crew. Stan Barrett demanding to be taken out of the car as it's getting very hot in there. 1,400 pounds of hydrogen peroxide continuing to cook. The crew continues to work effectively, and finally, the rocket is disarmed. Stan Barrett's friend, Pat Boone, naturally is concerned.
Oh, yeah, yeah, because you keep asking yourself, you know, why? Why should a man risk his life? And why should he jeopardize the future of his wife and his children for this? What's it going to prove, really? What if he does it? Then, I mean, has it proven anything? But more and more, we came to the conclusion that he had the ability, he had the background and the training, that it was possible, although, you know, a frightening possibility, and that he would do it as a son of God, really.
Stan Barrett's effort for the speed of sound will continue after this. Alien worlds are in quiet harmony as before dawn, the attendants arm the rocket for its sternest test. This will mark the first attempt at over 600 miles per hour.
Sometimes I just think about the run and what I might encounter, and you know, just getting myself really thinking about or getting down to business. I think about the maneuvers that I go through in the car, and maybe some of the criteria that we've talked about before the run, and where I'm supposed to shut off and where I'm supposed to deploy my chutes and things like that, and. Sometimes I just talk to the people that I'm with and, you know, talk to the crew or whatever. But it's kind of, I would like in a way just to go out there and hop in the car and go. This will be running. I'm really not depending on my own strength in this thing, or have I in any of the things I've ever done. I think I really depend on the Lord to bring me through these things. And I kind of feel like, David, when he was up against Goliath, I mean, there's no comparison in our strength. And so I just really petition the Lord for strength in this thing.
Hey, Stan, you read me over?
Loud and clear, Bill.
Okay, counting. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition.
The rocket is unbridled and unbridable. It is in the traps at over 600 miles an hour.
I'm leaving you.
The chute deploys. At this point, the cockpit hatch opens, but Stanley Barrett keeps the rocket vehicle under control and slows it down. Barrett, coming to a halt 7 miles from where he began. The crew is on hand to purge the system of the hydrogen peroxide, waiting for confirmation on the time. And there is a problem. The TV helicopter is too low, and members of the crew are covered with hydrogen peroxide. The safety crew is immediately on the scene to wash down 5 members of Bill Frederick's crew. And a half hour later, they are back on the job. And then the announcement was made that Stanley Barrett on this run had traveled through the traps at 638 miles an hour. As the telemetry was being checked out for this run, Brock Yates went to find Earl Flanders for a certification of this run made by the International Hot Rod Association in cooperation with the IFM.
Earl, what we know right now is that Stanley ran 638 miles an hour on your electronic timers through a course of about 1,500 feet. But what does that mean in terms of an international record?
Well, this international record, part of the process of this international record has been approved, and part of the process has not been approved because of the mechanics. It takes a long time for it to get straightened out. And I'm going to submit it this fall at the Congress meeting, and I feel certain it's going to be approved because I was given a guideline for it.
Now, there have been all sorts of world land speed records established one way across a measured mile, two ways, rocket cars, wheel-driven cars, motorcycles, et cetera, et cetera. When all those arcane regulations get boiled down and all of the disputes that may arise get settled, what have we proved here today?
Well, we've proved that this is the fastest vehicle in the world at the moment.
For rocket car owner Hal Needham and Stan Barrett's friend, it was a special moment.
I'm so damn proud of you, Stanley.
I'd like to look at my tracks.
It was a special moment for all on the way to the sound.
How are you doing? Why are you crying? Are you happy?
I want to thank three of my other boys, Kirk, Mark, Billy.
Thank you for your...
What did you think when you saw it go by?
Well, for a minute, I'm proud of him.
He did a marvelous job, didn't he?
He did. He really did. I'm just quite sensitive today. I didn't think it would affect me like this, but I'm proud of him. I just feel like God's plan is working.
Thank you, Penny.
Project SOS will continue in a moment.
Hey, let me have your attention for a minute, okay? This morning, we're all so happy and joyous and everything as to what Stanley did that we forgot to do something, and that's go look at the telemetry. And what has happened is he is breaking through the salt. In other words, we put so much pressure, in order to keep the car on the ground, we put so much pressure on it that when he hits, he goes through the salt, which means he's digging down about a couple of inches into the clay. But here's our plan. We're going to quit. Now, let me just say something else. The salt out here for people with rubber-tired vehicles is phenomenal. But for a metal wheel, it isn't that good.
These little scuff marks on this vast acreage of salt look innocent enough, but they're the fatal flaws that led to the temporary aborting of the assault on the speed of sound. Here on the course, Stan Barrett was traveling at about 500 miles an hour as he approached the traps at about the 2-mile mark. Here, the wheels began to leap off the ground as they drove through this thin layer of salt. Here, the right side wheel has come off the ground for about 40 feet. And the car began to tricycle down the racetrack with the wheels alternately leaping off the ground. Designer Bill Fredericks has decided that if this condition prevailed, there is a possibility that the car could be broken in half by the massive physical forces that come to bear under these conditions. Hence, we seek a better, smoother, softer surface to run on.
This past week at his old haunt in Tonopah, Nevada, I asked retired Air Force General Chuck Yeager if he was surprised at the outcome at Bonneville.
No, really, because when, as you start getting up into speeds above 600 miles an hour, things start getting light on the car, and any time you get a disturbance because of a rough surface, such as the Bonneville Salt Flats are, that sort of aggravates the situation, and it can get to be pretty hairy, and I'm glad to see Hal try to move this thing down to Rogers Dry Lake there at Edwards, because that's as smooth as glass, and it's a lot harder, and you won't get any breakthrough like you were getting up there skipping.
The nose stayed down, but the rear was flexing.
Yeah, because, see, you got a canopy back there and all of the struts, and you're getting a little lift out of that area of the car. And remember, we put strakes or canard surfaces on the nose and bent them down to give us 400 pounds download on them. And I think we're getting just a little bit of feedback from the surface of the salt. That's kicking that thing up in the air. As it begins to bounce, it aggravates the situation.
When you were there, did you ever converse with the guys about that? Did you ever mention, hey?
Hal and I discussed it a little bit, and the breakthrough worried me a little bit, because when one wheel breaks through, that kind of drags to the right, and then centrifugal force will cause the other one to dig in, and if it went divergent, then you got a problem. You've got an accident, and I tell you, the way they're running that thing, real careful and by the numbers, the way it should be, I'm glad to see him try to move to a smoother surface.
Hours after his run, I had a final conversation at Bonneville with Stan Barrett.
Was it frightening, Stanley?
Well, let's just say that we came pretty close to the edge today.
Not as close as you want to get. Well, now you have an interval before you go for the barrier. Is that going to be a period of relaxation or one of anxiety for you?
I think it's a little soon to tell at this point.
Can you get it? Can you go for the barrier and get it?
I think we can.
The barrier is still there. Stan Barrett still in its shadow. What's important to me here is that there is another name to add to that special list of people willing to risk it all for something that matters to them. That list that includes Thompson, Breedlove, Gabelich. Add the name Stanley Barrett. One of the ultimate adventures in speed, that adventure of Stan Barrett to reach Mach 1 SOS is continuing here at Rogers Dry Lake Edwards Air Force Base. Stan Barrett in the car. We are in the final moments of countdown. The temperature standing at 20 degrees, which makes the sound barrier 731.9 miles per hour. Kirk Swanson locks him into the car, and we are ready for the final effort in this series to attain the sound barrier with a land vehicle.
And there you see the rocket car, Barrett encapsulated in the machine now. There's the front metal wheel, which will be turning 9,000 revolutions plus per minute. No tire could stand it. The power plant at the back, 60,000 horsepower here with that hybrid engine and the sidewinder. And there's Penny McCoy Barrett with her children back in the pre-stage area, a mile away from the 0 mile marker where the car now rests. Car builder Bill Frederick going down through the checklist for the final time. There's car owner Hal Needham underwriting this project. He's rented the equipment and facilities here at Edwards Air Force Base to put Stan Barrett in the record books. What are Barrett's thoughts at this very moment in that car?
When we get into the countdown is a time that I also say a prayer, and I just say, Lord, into thy hands I commit myself. And usually that's about on the count of two. When he gets down to two, that's said, and he says one, and away I go. And it's, you know, although there's some real stress there, that's a time that I really feel close to the Lord. And I mean, I guess when you're putting it all on the line, it's a kind of a special time.
The pitot tube in the nose of the rocket car, the first object to penetrate the sound barrier, Mach 1, if they make it, and then the shock waves will flow down the fuselage and build up here at the cockpit, where there'll be a tremendous beating and buffeting for Barrett in that 20 inches wide, 39 inch area for the driver.
Okay, Stan, we're gonna do some burnouts.
All right.
Which number 7, give me a little one.
This is it. There you see the hybrid engine coming alive, the sidewinder just above it, 60,000 horsepower in this one final thrust for the barrier. Air Force radar will be checking this run, but after this one, it'll be back to the drawing board if they do not succeed. A quick look at the course Barrett will cover today from the 0 to the 1 mile marker in about 10 seconds, going 500 miles per hour, then hits the sidewinder 3 seconds later, and at the 2 mile mark should be going Mach 1. A half mile later, 1 8/10 seconds, he hits his chute and hopefully begins to slow down. There is General Chuck Yeager, the first man to go through the barrier back in 1947. We may be on the brink of a personal as well as a scientific and engineering achievement. Let's pick up the count.
Here we go, Stan. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition.
A perfect start. Stan Barrett roars toward the mile marker. Hits the sidewinder, heading for the 2 mile marker. We have seen this vehicle make some 18 runs, but none so flawless as this. The reaction of 37-year-old Bishop, California's Stan Barrett, one word for it, wow. Slowing down in the 4 mile area. Talk about whipping, rolling resistance. What a phenomenal run for car builder Bill Frederick. And right here, car owner Hal Needham going down to the 6 mile marker where the car has come to rest. There you see the crew picking up the chute. Stan Barrett still in the machine here at Rogers Dry Lake, Edwards Air Force Base. It looks like history has been made. We're waiting for the story. Let's look again in replay. From Air Force radar, watch as 12,000 additional horsepower, 6,000 additional pounds of thrust is triggered by Stanley Barrett with that sidewinder.
Gee.
60,000 horsepower working for 731.9 miles per hour. Did he make it? Hal Needham on the right, Bill Fredericks on the left, assisting Stan Barrett out of the car.
I'm going to announce what we got so far. We don't have Flanders speed. We ran out of fuel between 200 and 400 feet before the lights. We got 734 on radar, 739 on airspeed. We probably broke the speed of sound.
The dream of Bill Frederick.
Woo!
and Hal Needham for years is attained by driver Stan Barrett. And a special salute from one mockbuster to another.
And that was the story of SOS, one of those singular, solitary challenges that is so special in the world of sports. With me right now is the man who put it all together, Hal Needham. He worked on the project for some 5 years, and now that it's over, come the critics, Gary Gablich among them, the man who has held the land speed record for many years. He questions the sound barrier breaking itself. Now, how do you feel about that?
Well, Ken, I'll tell you something. The best thing that ever happened to Gary was the fact that we broke the sound barrier. It's the first ink he's had in 7 years. You see, what happened was everybody really thought that Breedlove still held the record. I mean, his PR firm was for the birds, so consequently, he should get out and do olives every morning, and the fact that we got him some more ink. We went 739.666 and broke the sound barrier. So the people in Europe that sanction all this, if they don't want to sanction it, I don't give a damn if they sanction it or not. We did it, so what are they going to do? We make our own rules. If they don't like it, to hell with them.
You know, Needham, it was on a dry lake like that one down there up here in Nevada 5 years ago that we first met. You tried to go 600 miles an hour, darn near killed yourself going off the end. Now that it's all over, do you have any feelings about ever trying anything like this again?
I'm not looking to do any more speed projects. That one's such a pain, and I'm really glad it's all over with. I'm content and happy, and I'm not looking to do anything else.
Why, when it's all said and done, did you do it?
Well, a lot of people had a lot of dreams in there. Bill Frederick, for one, that's been a dream of his for years and years. He accomplished that dream. Stan Barrett, he told me afterwards that it made his family become so tight because they saw this man go get in that car 18 different times and put his life on the line. And we saw his family, how concerned and everything they were. But anyway, overall, it was a project that everybody was proud of. It was a tough project, and the tougher they are, the better you feel when they're all over, you know. So everybody was content and happy, and especially me, and I don't want to do any more.
Project SOS, put to bed. One of the most exciting challenges we've ever seen here on the Sports Spectacular. Hal Needham, Stan Barrett, and Bill Frederick's attempt to break the sound barrier, which they did at 739 miles per hour.